Bonjour, nous sommes à Open World Forum et j'ai le plaisir d'avoir avec moi Simon Wardley. Simon, pleased to meet you. Simon is from Leading Edge Forum. And we have the pleasure to have Simon with us in this Open Standards for Open Cloud session, which is quite interesting.
Pleasure's an unusual word. It's not necessarily the one I would use. I mean, standards, the whole question about standards and cloud has been going on for some time, actually. And you see a lot of repetition of the same sort of themes. But certainly the group's extremely good. It's a lively discussion.
That's funny with standards. I remember somebody saying, what's cool with standards is that I can have mine.
Yes. So I remember, it was 2007, 2008, there was a meeting of the Cloud Computing Interoperability Forum, which had about 50 vendors there, all agreeing that they wanted standards and all agreeing that the standards should be whatever they were producing individually. So, of course, you get no agreement at all. What's going on? There's a number of different factors going on at the moment. I mean, cloud itself simply describes a process by, you know, it's just the natural evolution of a bunch of different IT activities from a product to a much more utility-based world. And standards do have a place there, but invariably in these sorts of transition, it's never a committee which sort of decides what the standard is. The market decides, it de facto appears, and then generally the sensible idea is to come up afterwards and rubber stamp that as the standard.
So as a researcher, you have a quite, let's say, large idea about who's doing what in this standard world. Where would these people from open source would fit in this world?
So the question of open source. So one of the things, when you think about the process of evolution, we often have inertia to it. And we have inertia to it because of things like past practices. So for example, with computing infrastructure, where we've gone from, say, products to more utility services. Past best practice in the product world for things like scaling and resilience was scale up and N plus one. Of course, we're now moving to a world of utility, volume operation, provision of good enough components, and architectural practices have to change. They're distributed systems designed for failure. And of course, if we've got large commercial sort of application estates in the past model, I mean, that's huge technological debt to the past, our legacy, which makes us feel reluctant about making the jump. So what you end up with is sort of two types of customers, those who've made the jump and those who are looking for reasons, you know, to continue the sort of past model. Now, so those who sort of look for reasons to continue the past will often talk about we need things like SLAs and blah, all that sort of stuff. Whereas those who've made the jump and have moved into that world talk about what we want is choice. We want a marketplace. We want multiple providers. We want switching. Now, here's the tricky thing, is that if you really are going to have choice, as in easy switching, you need what's known as semantic interoperability. And that requires that the providers are either running the same system or complying to a reference model, i.e. running code more than specification matters. Now, if that running code is owned by a vendor, that's a captured market. They set the tax, set the direction, etc. If it's open, as in open source, you get a free market, as in free from constraints. So the whole thing about the importance of open source and cloud are very much interconnected. And when it comes to standards, what you really want to see is the de facto standard being provided through open source means and open source reference models. And the beauty about things like APIs is, of course, APIs are just, you know, principles, ideas. They're not expressions, therefore not copyrightable. And so we already see several open source reference models building around the de facto standard, I'd say, in infrastructure, which is things like EC2, S3, EBS from Amazon.
Yeah, good point. So when we speak about open cloud, I generally say, for me, open cloud is quite simple. It's a very simple equation. It's a open standard plus open source. Would it fit with your view?
So what you want is a marketplace and switching between providers. So you want to have basically multiple implementations. That's an important part, and at least one of the implementations to be entirely open source. That's the bit that's acting as the reference model. So yes, I would agree that the idea of an open cloud without an open source reference model is, well, it's nice marketing, but then, you know, cloud is a great marketing term for fundamentally what is utility computing.
So what's the promise behind that? I mean, you refer to utility computing. Is that the way this market will evolve? Because for the moment, it's mainly made on silos.
So, yeah, I agree. So let's go back to the utility computing. Utility computing is what we used to call this before cloud, the term, appeared. I mean, the idea is date back to Douglas Parkhill and before that, so 1966, where he made the analogy of computing would be like electricity. You would have public, private, government computer utilities, both from infrastructure all the way up to applications. I mean, it's basically what we call sort of cloud. The thing is, you know, if you're selling somebody something, it's difficult to describe utility computing as an innovation which will differentiate yourself. So unfortunately we had this awful marketing term and now everything is just badge cloud and half of it isn't. Or I would say there's large amounts of, shall we say, what is commonly called cloud washing. So things like, it depends on which layer of the stack, computing stack you're talking about, things like infrastructure is very much in that, you know, that commodity utility model. And what matters to people who've made the jump is the ability to switch between different providers, to have choice. I mean, that's really the only thing that's important. And there's many ways that can be provided, and one of the simplest ways of doing it is adopt the de facto APIs in that particular space, provide open source reference models, and we're starting to see that with things like CloudStack and Eucalyptus and even OpenStack.
Yeah, so I think if we refer to what Lessig wrote years ago about code is low, we are fully in there. Mm-hmm. And so what is the next step, according to you? I mean, do people will recognize this power of software to manage the world or to devolve the world?
Oh, gosh, now we're getting into all sorts of wonderful different areas. So there's a standard process by which things evolve, enable higher order systems to appear. And so, for example, like nuts and bolts evolve from being, non-interchangeable components, more orderly screw-cutting lathe, suddenly got standard components, exposure of higher-order systems like machinery. And same with electricity. We got things like Hollywood, etc. And this cycle is part of a process whereby you always get new entrants, you get disruption of paths, you get explosions of unmodeled data, new practices, new forms of organization, and it just repeats throughout history. So going forward into the future, we're going to see more of that, but that's going to be probably 3D printing is the next wave, as in commoditization, the means of manufacturing, and that'll change languages and all that sort of stuff as well. And that's all perfectly, you know, situation normal. I mean, don't be surprised. But at this moment in time, when we're talking about things like cloud, as in utility computing, obviously we do have people who have inertia to this change because, you know, they talk about their legacy and all the rest of it. They take it to, somebody like Amazon or, a utility provider. If there's a problem, they say the end of cloud is nigh, but in fact, that's not really the case. Your architecture has to evolve, and of course, they don't like that. So what we're probably going to see is a lot of people with inertia being, to some extent exploited by vendors who also have inertia because of past business models, and they want to continue reselling the past just now with a cloud badge on it.
Yes. So I think if we invite you next year, will you be there?
Absolutely. I'd love to come along. Most of my work these days is about organizational warfare. So it's how companies compete and fight. So particularly things like the level of strategic play between companies and their willingness to use openness as a means of competing. You see vast differences. You see companies who are doing very successfully, who play these games, and then companies who sort of leave it all to chance.
But isn't the OpenStack a way to play this kind of game for Rackspace, for instance?
It is. I mean, fundamentally, you know, if you're going to go up against somebody like Amazon, you have to go up against their ecosystem, because it's their ecosystem which basically does all the innovation. They can spot the diffusion. They can commoditize those. And it's like if you fight somebody like Canonical, you can't take on Canonical with 600 people or 700 people. Canonical's only got 600 because they've got 80,000 developers in their ecosystem. Or it's like going up against Wikipedia saying, oh, they've only got, whatever, 150, 200. Let's have 300. That's easy to beat them. No, they've got millions in the ecosystem. So, yes, you can use things like OpenStack to try to create a competing market, but try to co-opt it as much as possible. That's the game.
Thanks a lot. I think we had a lot from you, Simon, and really sincerely appreciate your insights. And so, thanks a lot.
Absolute pleasure. Thank you.
Merci.